إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أما بعد فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار أما بعد إخوتي وأخواتي في الله السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته إن شاء الله this is going to be the explanation of the book منهج السالكين the chapter of البيوع باب إحياء الموات the chapter of إحياء الموات إحياء is from the verb أحيا يحيي this is to revive الموات this is a land that is a kind of a waste or a land that is not owned by anybody. You know, in the past, people can just acquire land with ease. So, the ruling of what is called Ihya ul-Mawat was introduced by the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But if the land belongs to a person, we know it is haram for us to take the land except with the permission of the owner, either as a gift or sadaqah or as a purchase. But for you to claim the land that belongs to another person, this is fire. Even if it is just an inch, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man iqtata qita'ta ard tuwiqaha min tahti sab'i ardin." So whoever takes just a portion of the land that belongs to another person, aw shibra min al ard tuwiqahu min Sabi Arabi. So the person will be tied with that portion of the land from the seven earth, just taking a shibr of earth of a land. So this is something that is wrong. What to talk of somebody claiming the whole plot of land. If shibru is part of land, the one who claims it without genuine excuse or without any right to it, if the person is going to be treated for just claiming a span of land, then what about the one who takes a plot of land from another person unjustly or takes acres of land? However, if a land does not belong to a particular person, does not belong to the government, it is not owned by any person, then this is called what? Al-Mawat or Al-Maita. That is, the land is like a waste. So anybody can claim it. So we said in the past, there were so many plots of land, acres of land that were in this form. So Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked about this. So the chapter is Babu Ihya al-Mawat. Wa hiya al-ardu al-ba'ira allati la ya'lam laha malik. So this is like a waste land that the owner or no owner is known for it. No owner is known for it. The land belongs to nobody. Belongs to nobody. Is not owned by the government, nor is it owned by an individual. So, and one can benefit from it. One can take possession of the land. فَمَنْ أَحْيَاهَا. So whoever revives the land or grows it or builds on it, be ahitin, by building a fence around it, أو حفر بئر, or by digging a well, أو إجراء ماء إليها, or by channeling water to it, أو منع ما لا تزرع معه, or it prevents ما لا تزرع معه, which will not be grown on it. Malakaha, he owns it. Bijami'i ma fiha. Bijami'i ma fiha. Together with what is contained in it, or what is on it. Illa al-ma'adina zahira. Except al-ma'adina zahira. What is ma'adin? Ma'adin is the plural of ma'adin. That is the minerals. Al-Dhahira, that are apparent. So when you see a mineral, so to say, on a plot of land, be it gold, silver, and the likes, so you see that it is a locatum, that is a lost but found item, or a something that belongs to maybe the people of Jahiliyyah, particularly if this is dog. So in the case of Luqata, lost word, found item, you have known the ruling, what you are supposed to do. When you see something like that, you have to announce it for a period of a year. If nobody shows up, then after that you take possession of it. But if the owner comes back to claim it with the description, then you have to give him back. Just by the fact that you have taken possession of it, you have spent it, so you have to return it back to the owner. But if the owner does not show up till the day of Qiyamah, then you are not responsible on the day of Qiyamah for having spent it. But if you spend it before a year goes on it, then you are sinful for doing that, because you are not allowed to spend it until a year goes on it. And you have to also announce it. You go to the place where you have found it. Around that area, you will be making announcements. Not necessarily mentioning what the exact amount that you have seen, but you will be saying who has lost something, things like that, so that people can come to you and they claim it, and you ask them to describe what they've lost. If it agrees with what you have seen, then in that case you give to them. But if nobody claims it after a year, then you own it. But your owning it or ownership of it is not forever. If the owner resurface again, then you have to give it to him. But if he does not show up to the day of Qiyamah, you are not going to be held responsible on the day of Qiyamah. However, if what is found is something that is not worth it, if what is found is something that is not worth it, then you can spend it instantly. If it's something that is not worth it, how are we going to determine what is not worth it? This goes back to the society. the culture of the people. Take for instance, in Nigeria, or particularly in Lagos State, if a lot of people, they lose, let's say, 1,000 naira, they will not be bothered. They will not be bothered. This may be different in another state, even in Nigeria. Yeah. If somebody loses 1,000 naira, say maybe so much disturbed. We are not talking about a particular person. We are talking about what will be the reaction of majority of the people in that society. So the culture determines what is worth it and what is not worth it. So if it's something that is not worth it, then you can take it and spend it instantly. However, if the owner comes, you give to him. Meaning you do not need to announce or AOE. All like what is worth it, you are not allowed to spend it. So he said, other than what Al-Ma'adin Al-Dhahira, the apparent and conspicuous minerals. So this most likely will be owned by somebody. So in the past, this is something that is very, or used to be very, very free. You go to mine and things like that. So only if it is petroleum that you have discovered, individuals may own it. But in the modern time, the government take most of this thing from people, did not allow them to take possession of it. But in the past, so they do that. And such a person is going to pay zakah of whatever he or she has gotten from that. So this is just by the way, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Man ahya ardon laysat li ahadin fa huwa haqqu biha." Whoever revives a land or a plot or a piece of land that does not belong to anybody, fa huwa haqqu biha, it is more rightful to it than any other person. More rightful to it than any other person. But this, as scholars have said, is on condition that he makes use of it. If he doesn't make use of it, the government may take it from him and give it to somebody that will make use of it. So because the purpose is that the land be taken and made use of. So if somebody claims a land or takes a land and he doesn't make use of it, so the government may decide to take it from him and give it to the one that benefits from it. So the authentic hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is, "Man ahya ardon," whoever revives a plot of land or a piece of land, so laysat li ahadin, that belongs to nobody, fa huwa haqqu biha, it is more rightful to each. Is more rightful to each. So you see, today a lot of people, they've acquired plots of land, acres of land, as a result of what things like this. But for now, it is difficult to just acquire lands anyhow, particularly in Lagos State here. So in some areas, you have to pay exorbitant prices just to acquire a plot of land. But in the past, you can watch, as long as you can do the task that is attached to it, so you can get as many acres of land as possible. So this is called Ihya'ul Mawat. Mawat Ihya'u al-Mawat. So it's a topic that the author has brought. Don't forget, last week we talked about al-Musaqat and al-Muzara'a, which we translated as sharecropping. Somebody has a plot of land and he gives it to another person to cultivate it. The person will implant on the plot, and both of them, they share whatever comes out of it in ratio or percentage. So this we talked about, that it is permissible. Or somebody already has a farm that he has grown trees on, but he does not have the power to be taking care of the of these trees of the farm. So he gives it to somebody to be taking care of it, wetting it and things like that. So whatever comes out of it, they are going to share it in ratio or in percentage. He said this is permissible according to the hadith of Rafi bin Khadij. Likewise, Jabir radiallahu anhu. So this is permissible. But one that is not permissible, according to the hadith of Rafi bin Khadij, is the one that you say, okay, whatever grows at this part of the land will be mine. Whatever grows at that part of the land will be yours. So all the hadith that says you should not partake in sharecropping, so they are interpreted by majority of the scholars in this light. Contrary to the Hanafiya, who are of the opinion that this is not permissible, particularly the Musaqat, which is you already have a piece of land where you grow trees. You give it to somebody to be wetting it. So they do not support this. However, most scholars they support this and they see it as something of a kind of musharaka, partnership. A kind of musharaka. So this has connection with Ihya ul Mawat as we are talking about. Then the next one, وَإِذَا تَحَجَّرَ مَوَاتًا, if he puts stones around a mawat, a plot of land or a piece of land that belongs to nobody, بِأَنْ أَدَارَ حَوْلَهُ أَحْجَارًا أَوْ حَفَرَ بِئْرًا, or by digging a well, لَمْ يَصِلْ إِلَى مَائِيَا, that we not get to his water. Our Ukti Ardon, I was given a plot of land by the government, for instance, for Wahakubiha. It's more rightful to it as long as he has done something on it. Walayam Likuha, he does not own that plot or piece of land, Hatta Yuhiya Bima Takadda, until he revives it with one of what we have mentioned. Either he fences it or by putting stones around it or digging well on it and things like that. So if he doesn't do this, the authority may take the land from him and give to another person who will make a good use of the of it. Bab al-Ja'alati wal-Ijara, the chapter of al-Ja'ala, al-Ja'ala, al-Ju'ala. So the jinn can be pronounced ju or ji or ja'ala. Wal-Ijara and al-Ijara. Al-Ja'ala, this has to do with what is given to somebody. What is given to somebody, the price that you pay somebody for doing something for you. That person may not be somebody that you know, but you are paying for doing something for you. Up display. So the time may not, the time that the person is going to use to do that thing may not be mentioned as well. You are paying somebody whom you do not really know or mention. You don't have what direct contract with him. You are paying for doing something for you. So the time may not be known. And at times, maybe the price you are given to the person may also not be mentioned. So it depends. So this is called Ju'ala. Take for instance, if I lose an item, let's say a wristwatch, and I say, whoever can recover my wristwatch, I'm going to give him 10,000 naira. Who have I signed a contract with? Nobody. So this is different from ijara. In the case of ijara, you see somebody that was signed contract. But this case, the person is majhul. So my wristwatch is something that may be majhul. The person, for instance, may not know the wristwatch. So for how long? I did not mention maybe in 2 days. The person keep on searching for it. So unlike ijara, in ijara, things like this will be want to be spelled out to make it ijara. That is, this thing, the person is being paid to get something done, to get it done. Take for example, I say, if you can treat my patient till he becomes well, I'm going to give you 50,000 naira. This is what? This is ju'ala. What I'm giving is ju'ala. And it's premised on what? Treating the person till he gets well. Till the person gets well. This is not ijara, ordinary ijara. In the case of ijara, the time will be mentioned. Maybe he's going to treat the person for a week, 2 days, and he's going to get paid for that. So whether the person gets well or not, whether the patient gets well or not, he is what? Employed to render a service for a period of time. So this is ijara. In the case of ja'ala, so the person is employed till something is what? Is done. Till something is done and achieved. So because people, they find it difficult to differentiate between the two. And that's why some scholars, they are not in support of ja'ala, like the Hanafiya. They are not in support of ja'ala. The majority of the scholars are in support of ja'ala. They say because there is jahala and gharar in it. There is ignorance of what, of certain things there. Who are you employing? For how long are you going to employ him? So what exactly are you employing him for? All these are not known. But for the fact that you have lost something, for instance, and nobody's ready to do that in free of charge for you. You need your item that has been stolen, or your camel that has run away. You need it. Nobody is ready to do it free of charge. So you have to attach something so that some people, they will watch, they will be interested because of what you have added to it. So that's why the Sharia allows it. Despite the fact that thing is not something that is really known, that is that item that you are looking for, it's not something that is known to people. And you are not employing a particular person. And the time that you are employing that person may not be mentioned. What matters to you is that the person brings that thing. Once he brings it, then you fulfill your promise. So the person brings it, and you fulfill your promise. So you will say that, oh, you are not the one that I expected to bring it, because you didn't mention a particular person. What you have mentioned is that who anybody that touch brings me so and so, I'm going to give so and so. And the reason why the majority of the scholars have allowed this, we have in the Quran, wal man ja'a bi himlu ba'ir. So whoever brings it, you are going to give him a load of what? Huh? A load on the back of the camel. That is, he says is about 300 sa'. He said it's about 300 sa'. So they know what is himlu ba'ir, what will be given to the person who will bring the cup of the king that was said to have been stolen. So liman ja'a bihi, they did not employ a particular person, it's general. So this, you won't call it ijara, you call it ja'ala. This wa'ul malik, some people may not have seen it before. So they start researching, asking people here and there, how does the cup look like? Yeah? So the person that is taking this upon himself to go may not know the cup. Then, for how long is he going to do it? He may keep on searching for it. So the date is not mentioned. Unlike the case of ijara, in ijara, they mention the day that you are going to do it. Obviously. So, in the case of ijara, this is clearer than the case of ja'ala. In ja'ala or ju'ala, there is a lot of things that are not clear here. Ordinarily, would have said it is haram. Because the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam naha an bi'il ghara, he forbid ghara. But this thing, you need it, and nobody or many people are not ready to do this thing for you free of charge. Unless you give them a kind of wage, that is when they are going to show interest in looking for it. So for this reason, the Sharia says, okay, no problem. You can give them something. You can give them something. So they use as evidence, وَلِمَنْ جَاءَ بِهِ حِمْلُ بَعِيرٍ. Likewise, the hadith of Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, radiallahu anhu, when some companions were traveling and they got to a place, a community, where they sought for assistance that the people should host them, but they refused to host them. And we know in the Sharia, it is compulsory on you to host somebody who is traveling from another place not within the state in which you are. Maybe coming from another state, it is compulsory on you to host such a person just for a day and a night. Huh? So then if you do more than that, it is a sadaqah, a nari sadaqah. But the Sharia makes it a kind of compulsory that you say a stranger. Huh? So you host him. Huh? So you host him. So these people, they requested for assistance. They said, no, we are not going to host you people. As Allah would have it, the head of the tribe was stung by a scorpion or bitten by a snake. So the people started looking for treatment for it, but to no avail. They had to run after those people that they had refused to host. That Al Minkum in Rock, is there any person amongst you that knows how to do riqya? So Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, in one of the reports, said he was the one that did it. So he started reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. And it was just spitting a little on it. And the person became well. كَأَنَّمَا نَشِطَ مِنْ إِقَارٍ. So he was very okay, he became well. So, but before Abu Sa'id Khudri read, he stipulated that we are not going to treat him until we take a quarter in Al Ghana. That is a flock of sheep. So, and they agreed that, okay, no problem, we are going to give you. The most important thing to us is for the man to get in. And he read it, and the man became okay. So they took this sheep. They didn't eat it. They had to take it to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, خُذُوا وَضْرِبُوا لِي مِنْ أَبِي سَحْنِ. Take them and also give me a share from it, so that they will know that it is permissible, they won't have doubt. In one report, he said, خَيْرُ مَا أَخَذْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ. The best thing you take ajr for, which is Kitabullah, the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that is the wage that you have collected from those people is halal. This hadith, according to the Hanafiya, says it is permissible to do ruqya and get money for that. Because they did ruqya for the man and the man got well. So it is permissible to do ruqya and get money. However, this does not mean you open a center for ruqya. This is against the practice of the pious predecessors. None of the pious predecessors opened a center for ruqya and will be collecting money from people. But it happens once in a while, somebody comes to you to do ruqya for him, and you do the ruqya, you get something for that. No harm. To do it free of charge, that is the best. But if you take something for that, there is no harm. It's like you are treating the person. And it is permissible for a doctor to watch, to take a wage for the treatment. However, as we said, opening a center for ruqya is against the practice of the pious predecessors. So we should differentiate between the two. So the Hanafiya, they are in support of this. And the Jumhur of the scholars are also in support of. However, some, with respect to teaching people the Quran and taking money from people, these are a lot of ahadith that go against it. There are a lot of ahadith that go against teaching people Quran and taking money for that. However, if you take money with the intention of compensating your time, not for the Quran that you have taught the person, or the issues of the deen that you have taught the person, this is also permissible. This is permissible. So the money you are taking is for the time you have spent, not for the job that you have done. I hope this is clear. So this is the view of a lot of scholars, that the basis is that it's not permissible for you to take money when you are teaching people the Quran. What about خَيْرُ مَا أَخَذْتُمْ عَلَيْهِ أَجْرًا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ? You say the Hanafiya restrict this to what? Ruqya. Because the hadith came on what? Ruqya. So they restricted it to ruqya. The Jumu'ur, they extend it to what? To other than ruqya. However, it will do what? Not because you teach them the Quran. Why? Because there are other hadith that prohibit this. But because of what? The time that you have expended. Sheikh Usman ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala tried to balance the situation. That if you are poor, you can take. Like in the case of the companions, you know, they are what? They were in need of money. They were in need of what to eat. So it will be permissible in that instance for you to take. But if you are working, you teach people the Quran or you teach them the deen, you don't take money from them. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said concerning the one who is taking care of the wealth of the orphan, he said, فَمَنْ كَانَ غَنِيًا فَلْيَسْتَعَفِ وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا فَلْيَأْكُلِ الْمَعْرُوفِ. So whoever is ghani, who has enough, فَلْيَسْتَعْفِ, he should maintain a kind of restraint. That is, he shouldn't take from the wealth of the offer. وَمَنْ كَانَ فَقِيرًا, whoever is poor, فَلْيَأْكُلْ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, he should eat in a way that doesn't go against the custom. How this is played. So Shaykh Ibn Taymiyyah liking the case of the one who is teaching people the Quran or the Deen to this, considering other ahadith, the basis is that you are not supposed to take. But if you do not have, somebody must teach people the Deen, then you take money from them, because you are poor. But if you are well to do, you teach them without collecting anything from them. So, going back to the issue of the companion, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri, he took this, and the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, خَيْرُ مَا أَخَذْتُمْ عَلَى أَجْرًا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, in one report. In the other, he said, what خُذُوهَا وَدْرِبُوا لِي مِنْهَا بِسَحْنِ, take them, give me a share of it. Give me a share of it. This hadith, you know, some of these Jalabi people, they use it to say this is the evidence for the Jalabi that they are doing. But alhamdulillah, the Salafus Salih never opened a center for Jalabi. You can't find them doing that. You can't find them doing that. So, and that's why if you look at the books of fiqh, you will see them talking about things like this. So they talk about you can take. You can take when you do ruqya, you can take when you teach people. So this is what you can find. So this is the evidence that the jumhur of the scholars were of the opinion that ja'ala or ju'ala is permissible. They use this hadith as evidence as well. Al ja'ala is one of the uqood that is ja'iza, not lazima. And when we were discussing ar-rahnu the other time, mortgage, we said mortgage is one of the uqood al-lazima min parafin. It's one of the binding contracts from one part. Meaning, from the murtahid, from the rahim rather, the one who is the mortgager, the one who is putting down the mortgage, it is compulsory on him. He can't opt out of the rahim or of the contract. He says, okay, I'm no longer mortgaging my car, and he's not ready to pay the money that is in the person. No, you can't opt out. But the mortgagee can say, what? I'm no longer taking any mortgage from you. Go with your car. Pay me my money anytime you have it. So ar-rahm is one of what? Al-uqud al-lazima min tarafin. Al-bi'u and al-ijara, buying and selling. Likewise, lease or leasing. Min al-uqud al-lazima min tarafi, is one of the binding contracts on what? Both sides. Both the buyer and the seller. The buyer can opt out, the seller can opt out. But al-ja'ala is different from ijara. It is what? It is one of the rukudi al-ja'iza. The one who says, whoever brings so and so for me, I'm going to give him so and so. They say, what? I'm no longer saying that again. As long as a person has not brought it to. As long as a person has not brought it. Because if the person brings it, it has been concluded. But the person hasn't brought it, he may say, don't worry, let's forget it. Then the one who is looking for it, because he wants to get the prize, may say, I'm no longer doing it again. No longer looking for it. So it means it is one of the approach al-ja'iza. So this is also another difference between al-ijara and al-ja'ala. Let us quickly look at what the author says. وَهُمَا جَعْلُ مَالٍ مَعْلُومٍ. He said both of them, they are putting down مَالٍ مَعْلُومٍ, known money. لِمَنْ يَعْمَلْ لَهُ عَمَلًا مَعْلُومًا أَوْ مَجْهُولًا. For the one who is going to do something that is known or not known. فِي الْجَعَالَ, in جَعَالَ. وَمَعْلُومًا فِي الْإِجَارَ. In the case of ijara, it must be ma'lum. But in the case of ja'ala, the deed or the task may be known or may not be known. All this is clear. You put down known amounts and you say, whoever brings back my lost horse or camel, that lost horse may be known and may not be known. All this is clear. So, in the case of ja'ala, it may be known, may not be known. In the case of ijara, it will be known. Aw ala manfa'atin fi dhimma, or on a benefit fi dhimma that is coming, that is not present now. فَمَنْ فَعْلَ مَا جُعِلَ عَلَيْهِ فِيهِمَا. Whoever does whatever this prize is put down for, استحق العوض, he is entitled to the reward, that's the prize. وَإِلَّا فَلَا. If he doesn't do it, he is not entitled to it. إِلَّا إِذَا تَعَذَّرَ الْعَمَلْ فِي الْإِجَارَةِ. Except if it is difficult to do this in ijara, fa inna yatasaqqat al-iwaj, the iwaj will be dropped. Wa an abi urayra marfu'an, from Abu Uraira marfu'an, qala Allah ta'ala thalathatun ana khasmum yawm al-qiyamah. Three people I'm going to be their opponent, that is khasm, their fighter on the day of Qiyamah. رَجُلٌ أَعْطَى بِي ثُمَّ غَدَى. A man that gives somebody in my name, ثُمَّ غَدَى, and he betrays the person. وَرَجُلٌ بَعَى حُرًّا, and somebody who sells a freeborn. فَأَكَلَ ثَمَنَى, and he sells, he eats the price. وَرَجُلُ إِسْتَأْجَرَ أَجِيرًا فَاسْتَوْفَ مِنْهُ. And the one who employs an employee, and the employees are the man's full payment from him. وَلَمْ يُؤْتِهِ أَجْرًا, and he does not give him his what? His price. His wage. رواه مسلم. Al-Imam Muslim recorded this. وَالْجَعَالَ أَوْسَعُ مِنَ الْإِجَارَةِ. Al-Ja'ala is broader than Ijara, as we said, in that Al-Ja'ala may be something that is known or something that is not known, that you are what? You are employed to look for. لِأَنَّ أَتَجُوزُ عَلَى عَمَالِ الْقُرَى. This is because it is permissible to do this on عَمَالِ الْقُرَى, actions that you do in order to move closer to Allah. وَلْأَنَّ الْعَمَلَ فِيهَا يَكُونُ مَعْلُومًا وَمَجْهُولًا. And because the action or the deeds in it may be something that is known and unknown. وَلْأَنَّ عَقْدٌ جَائِزٌ, and it is also a permissible contract. بِخِلَافِ الْإِجَارَةِ, unlike ijara, that is what? Aqdun lazim. You see the difference? So ja'ala may be in what? In qurab. May be in qurab. Like somebody says, okay, madam, I want you to do tahfiz for this my child. If you can do tahfiz for this child, I'm going to give you 50,000 naira. Huh? This is something that is part of the Quran. It is permissible. How it is plain. So Ja'ala can come in that form. Ja'ala can come in that form. So but the case Ijara, as we said, trying to watch, employ somebody to come and memorize somebody the Quran. So this may not necessarily say, okay, he has to finish it. Maybe some period. Then as we said, that it's not something that is encouraged. It's not something that is encouraged that when you are teaching people the Quran or the knowledge of the deen, you take money. Except if we go by those explanation made earlier. Can one employ a doctor? When you employ a doctor to treat a child, he gets well. Is that Ja'ala or Ijara? Huh? Ja'ala. Because if you say you do Ijara, the doctor may not be able to watch, treat the child. Is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that grants shifa? But when you say, okay, treat the child, if he gets well, I'm going to give you something. Meaning you have not put this in his what? In his hand. That is the one that's going to do it. But if he gets well, I'm going to show gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by giving you something. This can what? Can fall under Ja'ala. This can fall under Ja'ala. But if you want to employ the doctor, you employ a doctor. This is to treat you until he gets well. So if he applies the necessary treatments and the person doesn't get well, that doesn't stop him from getting his what? That's, you see the difference between what? Ijara and Ja'ala. Ja'ala, this thing must what? Must be done. This is why the reason I'm paying you for this. In the case of Ijara, you employ him. Huh? You employ him, not that he gets that thing done. He may not get it done. So, and that's why Ja'ala is broader. In the case of Ijara, at times, we talk about Al Ijara, Al Ajir, Al Khas, and Al Ajir Al Am. Al Ajir Al Khas, that is private employee. Somebody that you employ to be doing something for you. If anything happens, he is not going to be held responsible. Unless if you can prove that he's negligent. You employ somebody to be assisting you to sell in your shop. Maybe a particular month, the market, so to say, the goods do not sell well. Will you pay him or not? You pay him. That is Ijara. You get it? That is what? Ijara. If something happens to the shop, maybe the shop is boggled, or somebody comes to the shop and overpower him and takes some things away, are you going to hold him responsible? No. Because yadu amana. His hand of what? Amana. Unless if you have evidence that he has been negligent, that is when he's going to be held responsible. But if it is Ja'ala, I'm going to pay you if you are able to sell, I'm employing you. I will give you money if you're able to sell this thing. You see the difference? That is Ja'ala. Huh? Yeah, I hope it is clear. You want to get this thing done. That is the case of Ja'ala. So Ja'ala is broader. At times, they may look alike in some angle, in some areas, but you will see somewhat differences. You still see some differences. Because in the case of Ja'ala, what you are implying the person for may be something that is ma'lum and it may be majhul. It may be majhul. The person that you are implying to do something may be majhul. The person may be ma'lum. But in the case of Ijara, the person must be ma'lum. And what you are asking him to do must be ma'lum. So if you employ someone that is what ma'lum, asking him to do something that is majhul. So you won't treat it as if you are treating Ijara. You treat it as if you are treating Ja'ala. Of his breath. And that's why he said what Ja'ala is broader than Ijara. وَتَجُوزُ إِجَارَةُ الْعَيْنِ الْمُؤَجَّرَةِ. It is permissible to also lease الْعَيْنِ الْمُؤَجَّرَةِ لِمَنْ يَكُونُ مَقَامًا لَا بِأَكْثَرَ مِنْهُ ضَرَرًا. Something that has been rented out, that has been leased out, you can watch, release it, or you rent it, you get it. I rent a flat, for instance. I'm talking Islamically now. Can I re-rent that flat to another person without going to the landlord? I rent from the landlord a flat. Can I re-rent that same flat to another person? Islamically, yes, it's permissible. I can rent it, but on conditions. The condition is that I must rent it to somebody who is as bad as myself. Do you understand what I mean by who is as what? As bad as myself. Let's assume that I'm a bad person. I'm bad. And the landlord still goes ahead to watch, to rent that apartment to me. Despite the fact that he knows that I'm bad, it means if I rent to somebody who is as bad as me, I've not done something bad to the landlord. Because if the landlord can tolerate me, he should be able to tolerate somebody who is as bad as myself. But if I rent it out to somebody who is worse than me, that means I've wronged the landlord. Though they won't take it. You know, they will write it that you cannot sublet. But Islamically, you can sublet. As long as what? You are not going to give you someone that is bad. Now I rent a flat that I want to be selling provisions in it. And the landlord is able to accommodate me. Can I rent to somebody who wants to be selling, who wants to use it as a eatery? No. Because they will be cooking, doing all this thing there. And maybe the owner of the block, the building, may not like things like this. So how can you be treating it as if it's Amala whatever? Everywhere will be black. No, I don't want something like that. So when you sublet it to somebody who is going to mess that place up, so you have rented it to someone who is worse than yourself. All this is clear. So that is the point the author is making here. Maybe we should stop here. Inshallah, we complete it next week. Wassallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala ashabi ajma'in. Subhanaka rabbana wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.
Now, the first question that we have here is, and they are combining two questions that are similar. How do you apply the principle of Ra'aya to the whistleblowing of the federal government in which one exposes a corrupt person with their loot, such a person has financially compensated? Now, secondly, is if the federal government places a price the person to be killed, I mean to consider it as a Ja'ala.
Alhamdulillah wa salatu wa salam ala Rasulullah Abad. Now, if the government places a price on the corrupt workers, all the federal government employees, that whoever exposes, so and whoever has involved in one corruption or the other is going to get so and so. The basis is that this is permissible. It is permissible for one to expose the corrupt person. So that money put down is a kind of watch encouragement. However, if you know that this is what is used as a witch hunt, then in that case it will not be permissible. That is, it's not that the government is really interested in fighting corruption, but the government wants to use it to fight the political enemies. So in this case, it will not be permissible for one to be involved in things like that. Because you know that when somebody is very close to them, is exposed, they won't treat it with sincerity. They will not treat the case with sincerity. But if the political opponent is exposed, so this will be treated with the iron fist, or what they call it. So this is not permissible. But the basis it is permissible, because the corrupt people should be exposed. That's the basis. And you collecting wages for doing that, there is no harm in it. Allah.
What is the price of the person that want to be like, let's say Boko Haram, something like that? So can I go ahead and I'm going to be considered as a jahal?
Yes, it's a jahal. Whoever does so and so, whoever is able to kill so and so person, they are going to give him so and so. It's jahal. So there's nothing wrong with that.
Yeah.
On condition that what is the right course.
Yeah.
Not ayat killer, ayat assassin. That one is also jahala, but jahala, that is what? That is haram.
Now, someone is asking that, said about 3 years ago, he went on the site, and the site inspection, and he found someone found a phone, and being leader of the team, they gave him the phone. And he asked all people who were there, if any one of them was the owner of the phone, and said no, none of them. And he had kept the phone for like 2 years. Eventually, he opened the phone and found out that while the phone was with him, he was expecting that someone would call and say, ah, you've lost your phone, you'll come and take it. But he opened it and found out that there was no SIM inside the phone. Apparently, the phone was a SIM, a new phone. So, what should he do with such a phone?
Well, my advice is that now the person is permissible for him if he has announced it and nobody shows up to collect it. It's permissible for him to take possession of it after a year. However, I will not advise him to take it. The reason is that some of this phone may be tracked. If this is done, so the whatever excuse you are trying to put forward may not be accepted or genuine to them. So don't endanger your life. So in this case, it is better to take it to the authority so that they can do whatever they want to do with it. But for you to say want to make use of it, they may use that to trace you. So Allah.
Now,
I'm
still want to ask this question. A dressmaker or a tailor, and someone gave me a piece of cloth to sew with an amount of money, and the person has not come back to clean the cloth, neither has he come back to collect the money after 3 years. What can be done with such money and a piece of material?
Now he continues to keep the material. He's the sewn cloth, he continues to keep it as much as he can. However, if he loses hope, and the person coming, he may decide to do sadaqah with it. However, if the person shows up, he will have to what? Still give it to him. Wallahu a'lam.
He's celebrating Afwah. He's celebrating Afwah or celebrating permissible.
Celebrating Walima is permissible. Ira Walima to Al Quran. Walima of Idadi or Thanawi or Jamia, this is permissible. There's nothing wrong with it as long as there is no text that prohibits it. In the case of Al Ma'tam, that is eating, drinking because you have lost somebody, so this is haram. As a companion said, as said by Jarir bin Abdullah al-Bajali, he said, "Kunna na'uddu al-ijtima'a ila ahli al-mayyit wa sun'ata at-ta'ami ba'da ad-dafni min an-niyaha." Gathering at the place of the deceased and the family of the deceased preparing food for people to eat after the person has been buried, he said, "We used to regard it as niyaha, as a willy, so which is forbidden in Islam. So this is what is haram. But other wala'im may be permissible, like akiko, for instance, is a mustahabba according to most scholars. Some scholars see it as wajiba. So walimatun nikah, this is a mustahabba. According to most scholars, some scholars see it as a wajiba. Then other ones, like the walima of opening a new housewarming, which is called al-wakira in the Arabic language, or al-naki'a, if you travel and come back from travel. So all these are permissible. They are permissible. So they fall under permissible wala'i. Originally, the word walima has to do with the food for nikah, but they will use the word walima to refer to other foods prepared, to refer to other food prepared. So no harm. But a madrasa, the head of the madrasa forcing the students to do walima, this has no basis in the deen. It has no basis. This should be left in the hand of the children and their family. Okay, my boy has memorized the Quran or has been able to recite the Quran very well. I want to do a kind of feast that I will gather people and watch people eat. So this is something that is encouraged. But for the head of a madrasa to say, no, you must do this. So this type of imposition has no basis. Not to talk of forcefully collecting money from the people as it is commonplace today. So this is haram, Allah.
Now, one question is that, now, for example, a situation arises such that a man and a young person, or let's even say the person is not even a young person but does not know how to pray correctly. So he left the first raka
with the boy.
But the second, by the time he got to the second raka, someone else to it. So the man who knows how to pray, the man of the masjid, lost his salvation. He left. So the one who now came in the second raka left the salah. So if,
and he has missed the raka.
And he has missed the raka. You know, there are some other people who started from the first raka. What are they supposed to do in this situation?
No,
and
because
secondly, can someone who is going, who has not prayed through, lead the people who are praying, ask for it, is for that?
Now, this is a very simple question. What should be done in a situation like that is that the person who is leading the salah presently, when he gets to the third rack of his, which will be the fourth tracker, for instance, of the small boy, and other people have joined, for instance. So if there are no other people, if other people are joined before, as at the time when the small boy joins too, so they will remain seated. They will wait for the new imam to complete his own fourth rakah, then they will do tashahud together. And we make the same, they will make the same. That's one option. The other option is that they can do niyyah to iftirak. That is, take the intention of breaking away from him. So they will do tashahud and make the same. So they can also do this. But the first one is better. The first one is better. So as for the second question, the one who hasn't prayed Zuhr, can he lead those who are praying Ashri? No, according to the Shafi'iyya. Now the other madhahib, they are of the opinion that there shouldn't be difference of intention between the imam and the ma'mum. So on their argument, they based on فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ عَلَيْهِ فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ عَلَيْهِ. Do not differ from your imam. So this is the extent to which even the niyya. So this is the extent to the niyya. What about the hadith of Ammar bin Yas, Mu'az bin Jabal, sorry, that he will pray behind the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he will go to his... So this, they said, is his... what's it called? That is the compulsory salah. The one he prayed behind the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was nafila. The one that he prayed with the people at home is what? Is his own compulsory salah. This would have been very correct if not for the addition, the ziyada that was contained in al-Umm of al-Imam al-Shafi'i, where it was said that would be tatawur for him, and theirs would be faridho. So this addition clears the matter that it is permissible, that the intention of the ma'mum and the imam differ. So their intention differing does not fall under فَلَا تَخْتَلِفُ عَلَيْهِ. So he can lead them. نُعَمْ فَاللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ سُبْحَانَكَ لَهُ.
At this table, and I think that it's not looking very warm, but what you see, you're not doing. I think we need to get another table for our